For all of you who are here, welcome. It's good to be back up front again. I got an announcement. Ivor's got an announcement. And then Jeff has something to say. So you get the whole clan today and doing that. So a big thing for me is the Comedy Fest is coming up here in a couple weeks. And if you have not reserved your tickets yet, you need to do that. And just go to the Voyage website. You'll see a link there for getting tickets. They'll see a code there that gets you the tickets free. But what we're trying to do is we're doing this so we can get a count on tickets. But it's coming up fast. It's the 23rd, right? So 2 weeks out. So you want to make sure that if you plan on coming to get your tickets and get them soon. So last time was a lot of fun. We had a great time last time. The lineup of comedians this time is even better than last time. So you definitely want to make sure that you're here for a good night. It's a great time to invite somebody to church. It really is. So if you have a neighbor, a fellow worker, I'm going to post it at my work and let people see it there. But if you if you're looking for a reason to get somebody to come to church and just to walk into a building, this is a great time to do it. So make sure you take advantage of that. And that's what I got. You're up next.
Good morning. As you know, as treasurer, I've always got a project or two lined up here. The next one is kind of one of those. It'll be one of those unseen projects, but it'll be very valuable for those who are probably a bit hearing impaired. A couple people here could benefit from a hearing loop system. And I finally got a quote back from one company. The other company hasn't even come back yet, but the quote we got, it's a good quote. I validated the price. It's about $5,000 to install a hearing loop system. What a hearing loop system is, basically it's a coil that is installed around the perimeter of the church. And then if your hearing aids are hearing loop compatible, you just literally dial into that frequency and you can hear what he says, what I say, as long as it's patched into the sound system. If you're not talking to a mic, well, then you can't. You're still in the same boat, can't hear. But it's one of those cool things that I think we need to do for everyone so everyone gets a good experience of coming to church. So I don't have a final date when we're going to install it yet, but if God's putting something like that on your heart to help fund, it is $5,000. I haven't put up a board yet. I don't know if I need to yet, but we're going to just think about it, pray about it, and put it at the market as a designated fund if you feel led to help out with anything. Thank you for your consideration.
Also related to things at the church, we have a women's bathroom downstairs. Some of you have been in there. Hopefully only women, but I've actually been in there. So others of us who painted the bathroom recently, I've been in there. Full confession. We have a vanity down there that's ready to go, brand new vanity to put in. The problem is we don't have anybody yet to install that. So some of you know Iverson and I have a side business called Dumb and Dumber Plumbers. And the only thing is we don't do plumbing. So because of that, we have to sub out all the plumbing to people who know how to do plumbing. We only do painting. So that's the joke. Anyway, if you want to help out with that, we need someone to Iverson and I are good at destroying things, taking things out. We just can't put it back in. So that's where you guys come in. So if anybody wants to help out with that in the next month or so, we'd love to have that installed very, very soon, okay? All right, with that, also want to mention we have a new book study coming up for Lent called Life of the Beloved by Henry Nouwen. It's a classic book. Henry Nouwen is a well-known writer for Protestants and Catholics alike. And this book is about spiritual living in a secular world. Just want to encourage you to grab a copy. We'll talk about it in the beginning of basically the first week of March. It starts on the 28th, the week of the 28th, which is the last day, which is a Monday, which is the last day of February. We'll start out 4 weeks in March looking at this book chapter by chapter, okay? So I want to just highlight that for you right now. Check it out. Grab a copy. I've got one free copy downstairs that Jody gave me, so if you need a copy, want one, I'll give it to you after church today, okay? All right, with that said, let's move into worship this morning. We've got a full worship hour planned for you, so let's bow our heads and prepare for that. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the day you've given us today. Thank you for an opportunity to come and worship you in this space. Thank you for the sun that's shining outside that we get to enjoy. in the midst of the cold February day. Thank you for a reminder that you are watching over us, that you are a great God. Now help us to worship you with our hearts fully abandoned to you this morning. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. Welcome. Excited to worship this morning. We're going to start out, sing a few songs about God's greatness and how he can move mountains, he can part seas, he can do anything we need. I know John and Rob have led this one up here. I've sang it in the congregation. It's called Speak to the Mountains, and it's just talking about how God's bigger than anything we face. I don't know if anybody's ever felt defeated. Like, I felt defeated this week, and this song just kind of pushed me through it. And listening to the song online by Chris McLarney, he kind of describes it, and he said, this song is kind of just a middle finger to the devil. I don't know if that's okay to say in church, but we're doing it. He said it, not me. But I liked it.
Can't say that in church.
He was, yeah. Just said, this song, I wrote it, is kind of a middle finger to the devil. It is saying, you know, my God's bigger than all of these things. Anything you put in front of me, my God is bigger than that. So, you know, why should we worry? Why should we stress? Why should we let it get us down when our God is bigger? And I think it comes from this part of Scripture. There's a bunch of Scripture about moving mountains, but in Matthew 17:20, Jesus says, you don't have enough faith. Jesus told them, I tell you the truth, if you had faith even as small as a mustard seed, you could say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it would move. Nothing would be impossible. So anything that the devil's put in our lives to throw us off track, or our own doubts, or our own worries, God's already got it figured out. God can move that. He can move that mountain from in your way to out of the way. So with that in mind, let's worship. God is so much bigger than troubles I face. Why would I hunger for power or riches or fame? My God is so much better than all of these things. No, I won't be shaken, and I won't be moved. My God is faithful, his promise is true. So I'll speak to the mountain, oh, it's time to move.
Too high, no valley too low. There's no
Thank you, John. Thank you, Ben. Let's continue worship this morning through prayer. We'd love to pray for you. We'd love to catch up with you. Praise God for some things as well.
Troubled, heavy-hearted, come to Jesus and find your peace. If you're run down, empty-handed, come to Jesus and find your strength. He is all that you need.
All right, I want to pray before we move into God's message this morning. Father God, as we examine your word today, and the topic at hand is a serious topic, and I just pray that you would help us to listen well, help me to communicate clearly, and help us all to heed and hear this message loud and clear. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. Just after it got dark, on October 30th, 1938, it happened. Aliens invaded the United States of America. It happened in Grover's Mill, New Jersey. Some of you may know the story, some of you may not, but seeing this fire comet thing streak through the sky was Professor Paul Pearson, I think was his name, and he was a professor at nearby Princeton University, and he rushed to the field expecting to find a comet or, you know, a space rock. He gets there. What does he find? He finds something that looks like this, a cylinder, right? And as he's examining that, other onlookers are coming to that field as well, and lo and behold, a reporter from CBS Radio comes and begins to share this report back in 1938 of what was happening. Let me read the report to you as it was broadcast back then. "Ladies and gentlemen, this is the most terrifying thing I have ever witnessed. I can see peering out of that black hole two luminous discs. Are they eyes? It might be a face. But that face, ladies and gentlemen, it's indescribable. I can hardly force myself to keep looking at it. The eyes are black and they gleam like a serpent. The mouth is V-shaped with saliva dripping from its rimless lips that seem to quiver and pulsate. What's that? There's a jet of flame springing from the alien, and it leaps right at the advancing men. It strikes them head on. Good Lord, they're turning into flame. Now the whole field's caught fire. The woods, the barns, the gas tanks of automobiles, it's spreading everywhere. It's coming this way." Now, what happened after that report on CBS Radio back in 1938 was chaos. There were pandemonium in the streets. Looting was taking place. Women who were near giving birth were sent into early labor. There were people with shotguns loading their shotguns for what they thought was going to be World War II. Now, I like to tell that story. It's not true, of course. But everything around that story is, like, the aliens didn't really invade New Jersey back in 1938. But everything I said was true. Like, there was a radio report, right, that came on the air in 1938 at about 8:15 p.m. And that radio report led people to kind of go a bit crazy, according to all the newspapers back at that time. How many of you have heard the story before? Now, what was behind the story? Well, there was a guy by the name of Orson Welles. He was a 23-year-old actor, and he had a new radio show, right? He came on at 8:15 p.m., right after the most popular radio show at that time on CBS Radio, and I can't remember the name of it. He comes on. He's a newbie. And his radio show is struggling to get an audience. So what does he do? He knows in order to keep his radio show, he better find something dramatic, right? So what does he do? He buys the rights to the H.G. Wells classic, The War of the Worlds. And he rewrites it for radio. And it gets performed on the radio, not in Victorian England, but modern day New Jersey, right? Now keep in mind what's happening in the United States in the 30s. What's happening? They're coming off the Great Depression. There's the real possibility of war with Germany. This is also on the eve of just before Halloween. You combine all this together, and what scientists were even believing and saying back in the 1930s was that there really was the possibility of alien life on Mars. Like, they were teaching this, okay? So can you imagine the chaos when you tune into your radio, maybe late to the show at 8:20? It's already been going for 5 minutes, and what do you hear? You hear this guy talking about this invasion. Some were freaked out, as you can imagine. Some thought what they were hearing was the invasion of the German soldiers, okay? So people were really freaked out about all of that. And because of that, again, chaos ensued for a little while anyway. And I don't think he meant any harm by it. He was just trying to put together this dramatic performance. for radio back in those days. Now, I share that story not this morning, not because it's true, but because it does highlight something for us, and that is simply this. We are at war. Our war is not fiction, though. This is fiction, right? This war is real. So we've been walking through this series these last few weeks called The Habits of Grace. We've been talking about the things that we can do to go and grow closer to God. And so we marched our way through the study of Scripture, reading Scripture, prayer, and worship. Well, those are four practices that you and I can practice every single day, or oftentimes anyway, to help us grow and become more and more like Christ, right? And so I hope you've picked up on one of those, and maybe that's become a new habit for you this year. Reading Scripture, studying Scripture, prayer, worship. You're here today, so you're worshiping on a regular basis. That's great. So those are things we can do. But as most of you know, if you've ever tried to make something a habit like that, as significant as those habits can be, it can be hard. It can be a challenge, right? Sometimes it's our own fault. But this morning, let me kind of stray into a different category and say, you know what? The fact of the matter is we are in a war. The war is real. It's not fictional at all. And that war takes place oftentimes on enemy ground. So let me introduce you to a new series today called No More Lies. We're going to be talking about the kind of lies that we buy into that causes us to stumble and causes us to not practice these habits of grace that can lead us to become more like Christ. And today, we're going to talk about one of those lies that has to do with our enemy. As any war professional would say, you have to know your enemy. Who is your enemy? Our enemy goes by lots of different names. The dragon, the great ancient serpent, the father of lies. Oftentimes we refer to him as the devil or Satan. Those are common titles that we use for the person that we know of as Satan, more common than not. But this morning, the father of lies is probably a better title for him. So we're going to talk about him a bit this morning. And to do that, let me just say this as we get started. Here's kind of our first proposal. Here's my first proposal this morning, and it has to do with this. Not only do we need to know our enemy, we also need to believe that our enemy is real, okay? Our enemy, Satan, is actually real. This goes against, you need to know this, this goes against the common teaching today, both inside and outside the church, that there is no devil. How many of you have heard that before? That seems to be a common teaching these days, both inside and out of the church, that there really is no devil at all. Where does this come by? How does this come about? Well, it comes out of all sorts of things, but there's this common notion that, you know what, we're too smart to believe in the devil, right? The devil can't possibly be real. But Jesus would say otherwise. If we study Jesus, we see a person who is on the battlefield over and over again. And Jesus would never say the devil is a figment of your imagination, a human concoction, something like a troll or believing in a mermaid or something like that. No, the devil is certainly real. Jesus experiences that great temptation out in the desert from the devil, who is Satan himself, right? On three separate occasions, Jesus refers to Satan as the prince of this world. Three times. And the word that's used for prince there is a Greek word called archon, which means like the most powerful ruler of that city or village or town or area in the Roman world. So when Jesus refers to the devil as the prince of this world, what is he saying? He's saying he's the most powerful being in the world. The prince of this world. When the devil offers Jesus all the kingdoms of the earth, if he would simply bow down to him, Jesus doesn't say, well, that's not yours to give. No, because Satan is in charge of so many things in this world. We can probably safely say that all the human horrors of history can be attributed to Satan. I think they really can be attributed to Satan. So much of what we see in history, that's just horrific. That's awful. can be attributed to Satan. Satan is behind a lot of that stuff. Yes, Jesus came, we know this, to get rid of the devil once and for all, right? We know this, and it did happen. But it's kind of like D-Day in World War II. You remember that big battle that took place? It was basically, by most experts, the beginning of the end, right? But there's still several months, and Japan still needed to surrender fully and finally for that war to be over. Easter is kind of like that, right? Easter is the beginning of the end, but we still have some months and miles to go before we ever get to Berlin, okay? So that's what's going on. And while we're still marching our way towards the end of the war, the devil, who is like a roaring lion, right, is out there. And what is the devil doing? The devil is trying to trip us up. He's probably more dangerous than he's ever been, right? And so he's trying to trip us up every single day. The devil is real. There's this thing called the Flynn effect. I came across this last week. It's this idea, this notion that we are progressing, that we are advancing in our knowledge, and we are becoming more enlightened. And because of that, there's no reason to believe in the devil anymore. We're too smart to believe in that. This guy, I think his name was Joseph Flynn, he was a New Zealand psychiatrist, and he taught this. He said, you know what? I'm going to measure this, like, by IQ scores. And he did this. And he said, you know what? We're getting smarter and smarter and smarter. And therefore, we're too smart to believe in a devil, right? But you'll be happy to know that that Flynn effect actually was proven false, because IQ scores in other studies have shown that we're actually getting dumber. Yes, we are actually getting dumber. Yes, we might be more enlightened. We have things that we, you know, our grandparents could have only imagined, right? But nevertheless, largely speaking, we're no smarter today than our ancestors of thousands of years ago. But the Flynn effect would say otherwise. There was this movie back in 1995 called The Usual Suspects. And in that movie, there's a great quote. And here's the quote for you from the villain, Kaiser Soze. The greatest trick the devil ever pulled was convincing the world he didn't exist. I like that quote. That's a good villainous quote. But the greatest trick the devil ever pulled was convincing the world he didn't exist. So knowing our enemy and believing the devil is real is kind of where we start, which leads to my second proposal this morning, and that has to do with the goal. What's the devil's goal for you and for me? Well, it's death and destruction. Death and destruction is the goal. Now, how do we know this? Well, Scripture tells us this. In John 10:10, listen to these words that Jesus offers up. He says, the thief's purpose, the devil's purpose, is to steal and kill and destroy. Think about that. To steal, to kill, and destroy. He wants to steal your joy. He wants to kill your soul. He wants to destroy everything that's good in your life. That's what the devil wants to do to us. That may be hard to believe, but that's really what the devil's purpose is, according to Jesus here in John 10:10, to kill, to steal, to destroy. He wants to do all those things, right? Where there is love, what does the devil want to do? The devil wants to cause unlove, right? He wants to cause hate. Where there is beauty, he wants to cause destruction. Where there is unity, what does the devil want to do? The devil wants to cause fragmentation. We see this in the church today. Fragmentation taking place all over the place. That's what the devil does all the time. He's not in a business whereby he is trying to show life. No, he's anti-death. He's anti-life, I should say, not death. He's anti-life because he wants us to die. He wants us to be destroyed. He wants all that sort of thing to happen. So he doesn't want us to live the kind of life that thrives. He wants us to live a life that simply survives and barely gets by. That's what the devil wants to do. So that's his purpose, to steal and kill and destroy. He is trying to take over ground all the time. I like what C.S. Lewis once said. He said this, there is no neutral ground in the universe. Every square inch and every split second is claimed by God and counterclaimed by Satan. That's what's going on here when we think about Satan and what he's trying to do. Now, how does Satan do all that? How does Satan follow through on his goal of bringing death and destruction to you and I? It comes about with his basically strategy, and that is simply lies. If you have a Bible with you this morning, I want to just open up to John 8 for just a moment. And in John 8, and there's lots of this being shared throughout, but the thing that we need to understand about the devil is that he is the liar. He is the father of lies, which is another great title for him. And here's what Jesus says. In this dialogue that takes place in John 8, verse 44, just one verse, but it's a long verse, but let me read it to you. He's arguing with these people who claim that they are father or are children of Abraham. He says, no, you're not children of Abraham. If you were children of Abraham, you would follow his example. He says, instead, you are children of who? He says, the devil. For you are the children of your father, the devil, verse 44. And you love to do the evil things he does. He was a murderer from the beginning. He has always hated the truth because there is no truth in him. And when he lies, it is consistent with his character, for he is a liar and the father of lies. That's what Satan does day in and day out. He tries to breathe into us lies. Now, oftentimes when we think of the devil and his work, I think we get these grandiose images of what's taking place when we think of all the Hollywood films that depict demons and exorcisms and all that kind of crazy stuff, right? Diseases that come from him or other poltergeists or any scary nightmare you might think of, that's the devil, right? That is certainly true, right? We know that Jesus does exorcise demons in his ministry, but I think that's secondary. Like, most of us don't deal with that kind of stuff every single day, but what do we deal with? Instead, we deal with lies that the devil tells us about certain things. Like, that's what we deal with on a regular basis. Lies that tell us we're not good enough, we're not smart enough, no one cares about me, those kind of things. Now, lest you think that lies are trivial and not that big of a deal, I read about a story this week that really, I was surprised to come across it, and I don't know if you would have seen the story or not. I read lots of news, and there was a gal. Her name was Chesley Christ, I think her name was, and she was 30 years old, and she took her life this week. Anybody hear that story? She's 28. She wins Miss USA in 2019, right? She's a correspondent for a network called Extra. She's also a lawyer. She's an attorney. Beautiful girl. She takes her life. She jumps from her apartment building this week and takes her life. Now, we know, as you read the story, that she dealt with depression. She spoke out about the need for mental health and all that kind of stuff. And you find out that she'd been battling through depression for a good long time. And I don't want to discount depression and how complex that is. That's a very complex thing to handle. I get that. But I can assure you, while we might not know exactly what she was believing in that moment of her life, my firm belief is she was buying into some sort of lie that the devil, who was trying to destroy us, fed her, right? Some sort of lie, whatever that might have been. She bought into that, which led eventually to her taking her life. That's the kind of stuff that happens when we believe these lies that come from the prince of this world, the father of all lies. That's the kind of stuff that happens. So how do we combat these lies? We combat them with the truth, right? So what is truth? What is truth? Here's one definition of what truth is. Reality, or what we can rely on as real. So what's real in this room? The chairs you're sitting on, those are real, right? Because they're holding you up. That's reality. Combating this would be, how do we define, or not combating, but also we define reality. What's reality? Reality is what you run into when you are wrong. I like that definition. What am I talking about? Well, if you think you can fly, then you jump out of an airplane with no parachute, right? Reality is what happens several seconds later when you hit the ground, right? You couldn't fly. That's reality. And we always say things like, you know, that person needs a dose of reality, right? What you run into when you are wrong. So truth is reality. Untruth or lies are unreality. And one writer refers to Satan as the spirit of unreality. That's a good definition for Satan, the spirit of unreality. That's what he feeds us over and over again. So to combat, again, the lies, we need the truth. And where do we find the truth? We find it in God's word. Why do you think we've been talking about study and reading scripture for so long? Because that's where God's truth is. As we read God's word day in, day out, as we take time throughout the week even to study it, even deeper, what happens? We read truth, and that truth comes into our lives, and it changes us. It transforms our heart. It transforms our mind. That is what we need. The power of truth is evident, especially in God's word. Several years back, I read a book. It was a fictional science fiction book called The Truth Machine. And it was about these convicted convicts who were given one last trial before they were executed. And if they could prove that they were were convicted of their crime wrongly, then they would be set free. Otherwise, they were going to be exterminated. They were going to be killed. So they came up with, to follow through on that law, they came up with this machine that was 100% correct in telling you whether you've or truth or lies. And so they called it the truth machine. Wouldn't it be nice to have a truth machine that would remind us when things are true? Well, we have that, right? We have that in Jesus. He is our truth machine. He came to our world to remind us of truth. Back in John's gospel, he says this in verse 31, chapter 8, once again. He says to the people who believed in him, "You truly are my disciples, if you remain faithful to my teachings, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." Jesus came to set us free, knowing that we've been enslaved by these lies for too long. How does he do it? He offers us truth after truth after truth. So, if you're battling through a lie that says, you know what, my wife and I really just aren't that compatible, I think we should get divorced, the truth says, what God joined together, let no one separate, right? Over and against the lie that says, you know what, I need this to be happy and I need that house to be happy, I need this sort of lifestyle to be happy, is the truth that says, no, you can be content where you're at, right here and now. And so we have these lies that we combat with the truth. And I think one of the most helpful ways we can combat this is through what I would simply call the two M's, or M and M. Now, most of us know M and M's, right? What you may not know about M and M's is when they were actually made. Who can tell me when M and M's were actually made? For the person who gets the closest to the date, I will give you a family size M and M that you can share with your family. So who wants a guess? When were M&Ms created? Okay, 1930? Okay. Okay. Anybody else? 1890. Oh, 1890, okay. You know who gets them? What? Okay. Well, you know what? Oh, thank you, guys. You're done. No more. Isaac gets it. 1941, guys. Yep. Did you know that they were made for soldiers in the military? Why? Because it gave the soldiers some sugar in their pocket that would not melt, right? What was the old commercial? Melts in your mouth, not in your hands. That's what they were made for, soldiers. So likewise, we have our own M&Ms, not the kind we eat, but our own M&Ms that we can practice as well to combat the lies that come from the enemy. So I'm going to call these meditate and memorize. What am I talking about? If you're already in God's Word and you're reading God's Word, one simple strategy to add to that and stacking that onto another habit is to meditate on a passage of Scripture that you encounter that breathes truth to a lie that you're believing. So maybe you're reading and you come across a verse, and it's a verse that you want to stop on and spend some time on. Maybe it's just a couple minutes, but you meditate on it. To meditate means to chew on. And so you chew on that verse a little bit longer than you might otherwise before you move on. That's what I'm talking about. So when you come across a passage of Scripture that is truth over and against a lie that you're believing, man, spend some time meditating on that. Even better is the other M, memorize. Like maybe it's so good that you want to just put it in your head. Like you don't have to open your journal or your Bible again. You just have it because you spent some time not only meditating upon it, but memorizing it as well. So here's what I'm asking you to do this week as kind of some homework. And that is simply to figure out a lie that you're struggling with. Could be anything. And as you read through Scripture, and maybe you can go dig on your own, but maybe just as you're reading, because you're already reading, right? You're already reading Scripture regularly. As you're reading, mark on the other, like if you had a piece of paper, here's the lie on one side, here's the truth on the other side, and I want you to start keeping track of the Scripture on the other side, which breathes truth to combat that lie. And you're going to find lots of Scripture that will combat that lie. Lies like, let's take for an example, a lie that says, you know what, I'm alone, God doesn't care for me. What's a truth to combat that? Well, one truth would be, and I can't state the passage because I had it written and I forgot to memorize it, is a passage that says God says he will never leave us or forsake us, right? So that would be a truth that you notice maybe as you're reading through Scripture. And so you've got all these lies, but pick one and then just begin to keep tabs and keep a tally. And maybe you'll have five verses by the end of the week. Maybe you'll pick one of those to memorize. Have it up here in our heads so that we don't have to be reminded of it by looking at our journal or our Bible. It will just be up here. And so when the enemy tries to breathe that lie again, what will we have? We will have the truth at our disposal. Meditate and memorize, a simple practice that I think we can use to combat the enemy, who is Satan. So friends, final warning, the devil is real. The war is not fiction. This war is real, and so too is the devil. And to combat the devil, we need truth more than ever. I like what Jesus says here in John 10:10 to finish up. Here's what he says. The thief's purpose is to steal and kill and destroy. That's what we said earlier. But the end of the verse, it says this. My purpose is to give you and I, a rich and satisfying life. May he give all of us a rich and satisfying life when we heed and pay attention to his truth and not the lies of the enemy. Let's pray for that today. Father God, we thank you for a reminder of who our enemy is. It's easy for us to blame this group over here or that group over there or this situation over here. But God, the true enemy behind so much in our world that is destructive, that is fragmented, that is messed up, the true enemy is the father of all lies, who is Satan, who is the devil, who is that great dragon who's already been defeated, but because the defeat is not completely final yet, is as dangerous as ever. So God, help us in our battle to hear truth. God, help each and every one of us this week to hear that truth. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. So go now this week, replacing those lies by meditating and memorizing God's truth. Thanks for listening so well. We will see you again next week.